Greetings and welcome to the Thursday edition of the Economy and Politics Show. Today is November 19th, 2020. Our focus is always on the subnationals,
how it affects the populace.
What you also call states.
Today we're looking at Nigeria and the prospects for growth and stability.
So much spotlight is brought to federal government activities. What happens at the state is also important, and that's why we dedicate this segment to looking at development.
We're discussing that, and we have
the state level.
Joining us virtually.
Today we continue
conversation. Dr. Biodun Adedigbe, an economist and chief consultant of BAA Consult, to have this very robust discussion. Good morning, and nice to have you on the show, Doctor.
Thank you so very much, Dr. Abang. It's my pleasure to be here.
Okay, yes. We all are aware now that Nigeria is in a technical recession as the gross domestic product contracted by minus 3.62% in third quarter 2020. According to the report from the National Bureau of Statistics. Now, when do you see a feasible recovery? Of course, the government has proposed, and of course, the central bank, they are optimistic around first quarter of 2021, all things being equal in terms of what happens in the crude oil price, the drive towards non-oil sector growth, amongst others. But looking at our budget, which is 13.08 trillion naira, capital expenditure is 3.85 trillion, while recurrent is still around 6.11 trillion naira. That is one tranche. What for you is paramount for a sustained recovery? Not just a recovery, but your colleague, Dr. Doyin Salami, the chairman of the Presidential Economic Advisory Council, says we need a reasonable, a meaningful recovery. So what for you would be a meaningful and sustained recovery for Nigeria?
All right, thank you so very much for that. I think we need to first of all put this in the perspective that all it takes for the country to come out of recession is get a growth of 0.00001, no matter how tiny it is, that is positive. So that immediately takes you out of recession, technically, by the way. But that is why I like the question you posed, which is, how do we get to sustained recovery? So it is not just about economic recovery, it's about making it sustainable. So how do we get there? That means we must ask ourselves some questions. First is, how did we get into recession? And I will play the two recessions of the last 5 years against each other. 2016, we went into recession, and I remember vividly that I then said we didn't go into recession because of a change in political leadership. I went into recession because there are some defects in the structure of our economy that we were unable to change over several decades. And the first of them still subsists today, and that is our heavy dependence on hydrocarbons for foreign earnings. And that means we are highly vulnerable anytime the price of crude oil dampens. Or, on the other hand, the volume that we produce and export also drops significantly. So whenever any of those two play together, our economy always be in trouble in terms of the foreign earnings we generate. So now, that is on one side. Then equally, I pointed out then, January 2016, that the second reason why we enter recession was because we are largely import dependent. Again, our trade data over the years, looking back, not too distant anyway, from 2013 till date, has shown a persistent increase in our import figures. Okay, so we are importing more and more by the day. And we come to talk about the figures later. Now, thirdly, we have an economy where there is the mindset of everyone being dependent, so to say, on anything government. So we look at any area we can put our finger on where we can obtain subsidy. In which case, we call it rent seeking. So the typical businessman wants to lay his hand upon dollar source from the Central Bank of Nigeria at quote unquote the official rate. So all he complains about is that I can't access dollar from Central Bank. Whereas the way business is done globally, even foreigners that come to do business in Nigeria, when we do their cash flow projections, what we talk about is what is the most expensive rate at which you can convert naira to dollar. That's what corporate chieftains plan with. But it's only in Nigeria, everybody thinks about what I will get as the exchange rate from the central bank. So rent seeking, that's what we call it. Fourthly, we have an economy where our productivity is very low, low productivity. And of course, I also talk about policy rigidities, which means our policies are never well structured out in such a way that we achieve two things. The first is what we call internal consistency. That means if you take the monetary policy plan, for example, there is consistency within the context of monetary policy. Then there's also consistency across the board, where fiscal policy, monetary policy, and commercial policy are also consistent with each other. So it's consistency now at two levels, which have been missing in Nigeria most of the time. But the question now is, if those were the reasons that I identified in 2016 that got our economy into recession, which is why we climbed out of recession, yes, good news. But how can it be sustainable? Has there been any change in those five factors as of 2020? And I will tell you, no. Because when you look at the data, as at the present time in 2020, at least going by the latest foreign trade data available, as at June this year, we were still dependent in terms of the value of our exports and earnings from it, up to 87% on hydrocarbons. That means crude oil, condensate, associated gas, still accounting for 87% of our foreign earnings. All right? Put that on one side. Import dependency, as at June this year, the same foreign data, you find that for the first time in recent times, the volume of our imports was greater than the value of our exports. That is between April and June 2020. Okay? And if you look at the actual figures, you are looking at about 1.374, okay? And that is trillion naira on a monthly basis. Convert that to, you know, dollars, using the official exchange rate, that gives you $3.8 billion imports every month, okay? So now, when that happens, that means the mindset and the conduct of Nigerians haven't changed between 2016 and now. We still largely believe that anything imported is of superior value, superior quality, and so we still go for it. Now, in terms of policies, our policies internally consistent, and we say no, that has not changed. Okay, recently, the government put out the policy that says, okay, vehicles for transportation, we reduce the tariff on that. Vehicles for, cars and the rest of them, we reduce the tariff without taking into account that activities have resuscitated now in Ban, in Kaduna, and also in Volkswagen Lagos. So these have been done to revive that automotive sector. But we are putting out a policy that we now start in 2021 that in fact will be counterproductive to domestic production in that particular sector. So that means that nothing has really changed in terms of the structure and the rigidities in our system. So if therefore we are going to get sustained recovery after we climb out of this, technically, as I said earlier, with just 0.0001% positive growth rate, it then means we must frontally address these issues. That disconnect between the oil and non-oil economy must be addressed. Until we address that, where non-oil sector contributes the bulk of your GDP, whereas your foreign earnings is dominated basically by hydrocarbons. That has been a major issue for us. So until there is a connection between the oil economy and non-oil economy, we won't get there. And now with the kind of budgets we are looking at today, where the percentage of capital spending is far, far less than the current spending. That means we haven't found the political will and the courage to deal with the elements, the cost elements that aggregate into our current expenditure. And until we're able to deal with those elements, which are basically reflecting in the cost of governance, we may not get any enduring recovery going forward.
Very, very clear point, particularly the five issues of 2016, which you
highlighted again, has not been addressed in 2020. Which means there's a lot that has to do in the structural component of our economy. I know that you were in the economic advisory team for late President Umaru Yar'Adua, advising on how they can drive policies that would boost our industrialization and competitiveness.
Let's look at Nigeria presently. Last conversation we had with you was quite insightful, where you talked about the need for us to have at least two or three key sectors that are pivots of our economic transformation and competitiveness. You even listed United Arab Emirates and Dubai, even in UAE, that's known for tourism. And like you rightly said, even recently in interacting with several Nigerians, they found that place as a top hub for tourism. And that's a huge revenue earner for Dubai and, of course, the UAE. In Nigeria, currently the conversation, like the Central Bank of Nigeria governor had said recently, trying to incentivize banks to look at sectors like ICT, information and communication technology, and agriculture. You've also raised that, he corroborates what you've raised about what we've seen in the ICT and the agro sector. But in terms of policy going forward, are those the two key sectors that should be the focal point for fiscal and monetary to align to drive? Are there additional sectors that we can begin to drive to really achieve this growth? Because recently you talked about the need for a policy that drives jobs and also growth. It's not just about growth, but jobs, because there's a high unemployment rate in Nigeria, about 27%.
Yeah. Thank you so very much. Now, and I'm happy you brought up this issue, because each time we look at our economy, especially in terms of contribution of sectors to GDP, now, in the last 7 years, there are about six sectors that have been dominant in contributing to GDP. And on a quarterly basis, if you take their contribution, it has ranged between 77% and 82%. And those six sectors are agriculture, we have mining and quarry, we have manufacturing, we have trade, we have ICT, and then we have real estate. Now, I mentioned them because that is the way they appear on the pie chart that I construct every quarter once the GDP data is published. Okay. Now, if you look at these six, and in terms of the direction of policy, if GDP is a reflection of the value of economic activities taking place within our borders, that in those sectors is where most values are created. But now the next question is to ask ourselves, how important to a sustainably grow economy will be this sector? Okay, how important is agriculture? Agriculture serves two basic purposes. First is to feed and ensure food security. The second one is to produce what we go as raw material into either domestic production or what you can process in value addition. At times you use the word beneficiation, if you want to also stretch that to mining and quarry, so that you add value locally before you export it. Now, it's then that if we incentivize agriculture, then we are in a position to create a lot of jobs. Because agriculture that we still doing today is not fully mechanized. So that is a sector where you can create so many jobs. Right? So how we can grow is not just about throwing money at the sector. It has to be done in a properly structured manner. How do I mean? You look at the value chains of every major agricultural produce. Let's take, for example, now you do an analysis of the data in terms of consumption. And you also look at the structure of our imports. If we import food items, which food items do we import? That, in fact, is where you begin from. Because my own interpretation of importation is this. Anytime you spend one single naira on an imported item, what you are doing is you are creating jobs offshore. Okay? So if I want to replace the jobs being created offshore, that means I must begin to look at how we produce what we have been importing. But put attention more on the ones that are dominant in that import basket. Okay? Now, look at the value chain of that. The value chain begins from the farm where cultivation is done. The cultivation doesn't start on its own unless there's what we call land preparation.
Yes.
Now, that is where the whole problem starts from. There is no investment in land preparation in Nigeria that is driven by the government. And we can learn from Algeria many years back. Algeria actually in Africa. In their own case, what the government did was to put out money for land preparation. Because to prepare a land for a particular produce, it might be that we waste 2 to 3 years before that land is ready for cultivation. So which bank will provide for you a loan for that preparation? That also ties into productivity. Because if the land is not prepared for the type of crop you want to produce, the likelihood is that the productivity at the end of the day will be very low. So if you are aiming at a high productivity, it must start from land preparation. Okay, in which case, those, you know, farmers and those invested in agriculture must have access to such funds that are of long gestation, which is a moratorium of 2 to 3 years with respect to land preparation. No commercial bank will give you a loan for that. Okay, so that means this has to be driven by policy. That's on one hand. Then look at the entire value chain of a particular item, then ask yourself, what and what do we require there from the farm to the dining table? Okay, which activities are involved? What are those things required at every stage of that value chain? Those are the things that we target to fund, not just throw money out to agriculture and say, okay, we have provided this fund for agriculture. Which particular activity along the value chain do we want to place emphasis on? I was a part of a conversation last year, or was it early this year? Okay, that is related to commodities exchange.
Yes.
Now, one of the major agro-aligned operators in Nigeria is an old one listed on the stock exchange. The CEO came to that meeting and said, look, if that commodities exchange can guarantee him access to $100 million worth of maize, he'd be willing to partner them. Of course, everybody said, began to talk that, look, $100 million worth of maize. Because the man said, they spend that much importing corn and some other agricultural produce. But if that exchange is structured in such a way that can give them access to quality, because they specify the qualities too, you know, moisture content and the rest of them.
Yes.
So
yes,
if we can get access to this locally here, we have no business importing. That was what the man told us. So it then means that the issue is about the value chains.
Value chains, yes.
We are throwing money to rice, or we are throwing money to tomatoes, or any other agricultural produce. Okay? Now, look at ICT. I will give you examples in ICT.
Okay.
Everybody knows India, so I won't talk about India. Mm-hmm. But take a look just across us here, Ghana. Some years back, the Ghanaian government put a policy in place that, look, if you are a foreign investor that wants to invest in ICT, there are certain incentives available to you, but that will only be accessible if you bring in not less than $20 million to invest. In which case, that space is open, incentives are available if you are a foreign investor in ICT, but only if you are bringing that quantum of funds to invest in that sector. So in which case, every policy, you know, we put together must focus on what we want to get out of it. But how late do we do that? We just throw out a policy, yes, we've done a policy on this, and this is how we're going to put into it, and that is it. Exactly. Look at the
value chain.
So in fact, what it is, we describe it conceptually as the concept of economic cluster.
Yes, clusters. Yeah.
So where are the clusters of economic activity? Real estate is one I want to miss out here before we go to the next question.
Definitely.
Real estate is very critical if you want to develop the economy. Yes, housing deficit in Nigeria is estimated now between 21 and 22 million units. That's the deficit. Okay? It's been growing with our population because we're not also building to match the growth of our population on the one hand. But the real issue for us is affordable housing. If we put incentives that will drive affordable housing, that's for the real estate sector. Otherwise, I tell you here that real estate can produce and provide a lot of jobs in this economy. And don't forget, it's one of the top six.
You're right, because this last quarter, construction was among the
drivers of growth. So definitely, if that is done in real estate, we will see more activity in that regard. And affordable housing is very important. UN Habitat said Nigeria is home to one of the largest amount of slums in the world, which is not a good report
for an economy like Nigeria. But Doctor, I'd like you to quickly look at one area that's been, of course, major discussion point over the years and still this year, and that's the exchange rates. I mean, of course, we've discussed about this, and the central bank has looked at it and said, yes, there's need to move towards that unification of the exchange rates to address all the issues of arbitrage and all those other disparities, and even tackle issues of speculators. But like you rightly said, given that Nigeria is largely dependent on hydrocarbons and the revenue for dollar inflows, what remedial solutions can be done in the interim to prevent this thing we're seeing around the free fall of the Naira? Yes. And the power market is about 500 and maybe heading more than that. There's still the official is around 380, 390.
Okay, there are several issues around the exchange value of the Naira. You know, we can be mechanical in our analysis by merely talking about the factors that move the exchange rate. The most fundamental of them be the interplay between the demand and supply for foreign currencies. But the basic thing is this: the demand for foreign currencies is itself a direct demand. Because I don't need dollars for the sake of just holding dollars, unless I'm a speculator, okay? Or I'm now thinking about hedging against inflation if you run in a high environment.
Yes.
That means that if I demand for dollars, for example, it is because I have some things I want to buy from the rest of the world, so which I will use dollars to pay for. But when you sit back a little and look at the trajectory of our economy, starting back to when we collected data on the exchange value of the Naira, 1970. Now, when you look at the charts that you produce in terms of the exchange value of the Naira from 1970 till date, we see a pattern of a huge depreciation of the Naira since the mid-1980s. Now, why did that happen? I mentioned it and referenced it now. Our high import dependency, okay? We have a very high propensity to import. And until that changes, vis-a-vis what we produce locally, and I will cite a few examples to illustrate this. I was a part of a team of consultants way back in 1988 that were engaged by the federal government and World Bank to do a steel subsector review of Nigeria. And it is very important to mention this because when we went on that, there was still, you remember, the interest divide in terms of politics globally.
Yeah.
There are two major steel plants in Nigeria, Ajakuta and Alaja. Now, the one in Ajakuta, technology is from Russia. Okay? We call it the blast furnace technology. The one in Wari, the technology is from Europe. We call it direct reduction technology. Two different technologies. But the point really is this: if you decide to put your effort on Ajakuta, that means you will have to rely on the Russians for maintenance. That's the political side to it. But if your focus is more on Alaja, they will depend on Europe. So for them, it is business. But we think it is politics. But for them, it is basically economics. Then the idea came up that we should do a final report that we recommend that Ajakuta should be scrapped. Okay? Now for the Nigerians in that team, because we had also foreign consultants involved. And it is important to mention this. But how do people mention this? We wrote a minority report that went to the federal government of Nigeria. Remember then, it was Babangida as our president.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
And I almost was his vice.
Vice president, yeah.
Good. So we sent the report to the VP's office because it was an almost that announced it to the entire world that Nigeria would not scrap Ajakuta. And for your information here, and I think the audience knows this, go and check the record. Between 1988 and 1990, Nigeria did not get any fresh water. as a result of this policy adopted by the government of Nigeria. Okay? But in the process of that study, what did we find out? We found out that the South Koreans took the plan of Ajaokuta and constructed a replica of it. But between 1988 and today, I have two cars in my garage. The two of them are made in South Korea.
Wow.
But not only that, Kia Automobile is from South Korea. All right? Two things to note there. When Kia first came to Nigeria, it was with a brand called Capital, K-A-P-I-T-A. That was the brand called Kia. Many brands in Nigeria bought that. But the car was so poor quality that within 6 months, many of them disintegrated. So we stopped buying Kia automobiles then in the 90s. But the South Koreans continued to buy their own product. They didn't label it as substandard. But in the course of time, Kia Motors improved in quality.
Yes.
Now by 2013, it won the award in the home of automobile, which is the US, as the fastest selling automobile in the US. That was in 2013. So the 90s is this. If the Koreans kept buying Kia Motors and gave it opportunity to improve in quality, to now come to work by 2013 and now become so popular in terms of sales, even where automobile originated, that tells you something here about the difference between them and us. India, at some point in their history, the leader said, if Indians cannot close themselves, then let every Indian go naked. Okay, the policy was made that we will only buy what is made in India and wear what is made in India. This year, 2020, the United Arab Emirates got to a point and said, listen, we are no longer going to import PPEs and face masks from China. We're going to produce everything here on the ground in UAE. The Bank of Japan, the Central Bank of Japan, this year also, in response to COVID-19, said put out $240 billion for manufacturers in Japan to produce what they used to import from China. The latest is Taiwan, which is similar to what is played out between Nigeria and Ghana.
Yes.
Manufacturers left Taiwan in droves from China. But from the beginning of this year, they started coming back to Taiwan. All right? Now, the reason I mentioned Taiwan is because the same way exchange value of their currency is a problem they've been struggling with in the last 3 years, just like Nigeria.
Yeah.
To them, the way to go really is to look at three important things: what we consume and what we produce. So insofar as our focus is still on consuming imported items, that narrative will not change. Look back at Nigeria 1980, okay? We got at a point where producing Pojo 504.
Yeah, Pojo.
70% of the components, 70%.
When the Corona plants.
70% of the components of Pojo 504 were manufactured in Nigeria. Battery from the seat belts, and of course from India. You had also the silencer from Asaba. We had the seats coming from a company in Kaduna. He's even a friend of mine. Okay, I was producing the seats. And so many others from all around Nigeria, 70% of it. But what do we produce today? Everything is imported. So that narrative of around the exchange value of the Naira, for me, it is artificial because it is not driven and connected to what you consume and what you produce locally. So if you don't produce part of what you consume, that narrative will not change. I've said it repeatedly over so many years. And in the Monetary Policy Conference of Central Bank, in November 2002, I made it very clear to the Central Bank leadership there, okay, that you will continue to struggle with management of the exchange value of a currency. And I said, the reason is simple. That so far as it is easier for people to buy FX by the roadside, then not everybody will come to CBN. So if the supply increases, that means we produce and sell more to the rest of the world. And then on top of that, you make it easy to access dollars from the central bank. Then the regular patronage of the roadside dealer, we don't need to go there. And you notice for the first time, I think it was in 2006, 2007, there was a convergence of exchange rates when the rate at CBN was the same as the rate in the parallel market. That was the first time that happened since 1986. When you look at the data. So the question is, how did that happen? Supply increased. Within that period was when we had the highest in our history of external reserves, $64 billion US. Okay? We had a deep pocket in terms of reserves on the one hand, and then on the other hand, the central bank then deliberately looked at the requirements for points of FX from the CBN. So the combination of those two. So the question then is that, how do we take this economy away from dependence on the cost of foreigners? We must produce more here to take care of our local consumption and then produce more for the export market. How easy is it for us to produce here and export? That's just our export point as well.
So, Doctor, in a nutshell, you just
have been saying that productivity will be very key in terms of ensuring that we boost our exchange rate, and that is something that monetary and fiscal policy should take most seriously, supporting and ensuring that we drive our productivity as our economy. Quite a very, very interesting conversation, but so much to talk about, but just in 1 minute as we begin to wind down, could you speak to the year 2021, and of course we have the finance bill 2020 presented to the Federal Executive Council, which of course will drive into what we'll be seeing in the year 2021. The highlights are interesting. You've already raised some concern as it has to do with the automotive side. But in a nutshell, how will this drive outlook for economy next year?
Well, in terms of expectations generally, if you look at the progresses by the National Bureau of Statistics, by IMF, the World Bank, and analysts like us, we see an economy that will grow in 2021 faster than the rest of our population the first time in the last 7 years. Because our population is growing currently at 2.58% per annum. Okay? Now, IMF projects that the economy will grow by 2.6%. The World Bank is slightly a little above that. We see a figure around 2.7, 2.8. MBS projected when we're pretty good at the 30%. So now, if any of those expectations work out, it means our economy will be growing at a rate faster than the rate of our population, which is good news, right? So the question is, where do we expect the growth to come from? Now, interestingly, the price of crude oil for 2021 is being projected to end up anywhere between $58 to $65 per barrel by many stakeholders around the world. If our Citibank just put out a report last week that they expect the price of Brent to be above $60 per barrel, all right? And of course, Trafigura and several other, oil sector players have the same projections. So that will not be a problem for Nigeria. And the real issue for us is to further incentivize the key non-oil sectors of the economy, which if we do, then we will likely see the economy growing in the direction of sustainable growth. But as you said, policies are vital. I will drop this as my final note on this, that when we look at the finance bill, oftentimes, and this is the problem with our governments over many years, government looks at financial issues strictly from the perspective of how much revenue we generate. They therefore have difficulty giving concessions. And until the government begins to think about concessions to big companies, individuals that are faithful in payment of taxes, and now give them concession difficult times, they may not attract others into the tax test. If we get voluntary contribution to tax, if, number one, you make it easy for people to pay tax, which they have done some good work about, then secondly, give a window for true redress. That's a major thing that's been lacking in our tax system, redress. There must be redress that people can easily access. Do all this, And then we can see a finance bill whose content will support the growth of the economy. Then your policies also on tariffs. As I said at the beginning, there must be internal consistency. You don't reduce tariff for what is being produced locally here. Tariff structures around the world are money to make imports more expensive when there is quality production domestically. So let's leave it there. Because 7 minutes.
Very interesting points you
raised. I mean, the fact that, yes, there are good projections that for the first time, which is interesting to hear, we will be seeing a growth, likely growth above our population from 2.7%. Crude oil price looks good to go between $50 to $60 per barrel, which means go revenue and stabilization for Nigeria. But you've made the point that we need to further incentivize the non-oil sectors who are key pivots for growth in our economy, and the government concessions to companies that are tax compliant. Particularly in that bill, we are seeing some concessions for those that even supported the COVID relief efforts. But I guess you want it to be wider in terms of scope. That's very important too. And the ease of taxes and the window for true redress. Very nice point you raise. It's important. And of course, a very important issue that has not been really addressed effectively, our policy on tariffs. I think the Ministry of Industries, Trade and Investments, working with the Central Bank and other key players, would need to really address that particular issue, internally manage it well. And definitely, we should look for a bright 2021. Thank you very much, Dr. Biona Adedipe. Always a pleasure having you. Give us very rich insight on the economy and the pathway to growth and stability, and hope to have you in subsequent editions to discuss on Nigeria and its growth prospect and stability. Thank you once again, Dr. Biona Adedipe, Chief Consultant, BAA Consult, and Nigerian Economist. Thank you.
Thank you for having me. Yes. You have a wonderful day.
And you too, yes. And that'll be all for this edition of the Economy and Politics Show. You can join our website, www.proshenges.com, to watch our videos, read our news reports, analysis on Nigerian economy, and also send your views and comments on what will really drive Nigeria's recovery to growth and stability from recession to use at proshenges.com. We are ready to receive them and respond appropriately. To be coming away, thank you for watching. Have a nice day and stay safe.